right, like I was saying, this is my personal car. It's a stock engine Coyote, so it's got oil pump gears in it. Other than that, it's stock, stock camshaft, stock timing chains, you know, stock timing chain guides. I mean, it's a stock engine, stock oil pan yet, with a turbo setup on it. Obviously, it's got a single 80. This is a forced inductions S480, 96 millimeter turbine wheel, 132 AR T6. It's on E85. It's got an air-to-water intake manifold. Like I said, I didn't say this yet, but I have a build thread on our channel for this, so if you haven't watched any of that, check it out. I go through the build of the car and talk about the intake manifold, the turbo setup. It's pretty unique. It's a 180-degree header, so the car sounds very different. Currently, it's in, you know, what I would call more race car mode. I don't have the passenger seat, the carpet, the back seat's out of it, so... just did that turbo 400 swap, got the good old M&M shifter in there. Really just seeing today, the goal of the test is just to see how much power difference the turbo 400 made. Now keep in mind the 6R80 is a lockup trans, lockup converter transmission. Obviously the turbo 400 is not. I'm assuming it's going to lose some. The baseline before, a couple things that are different from there. The hood exit wasn't on it before. It was a full exhaust system before, which at the track, at the boost level we're testing it at the baseline's from the 6R, I didn't see much of a difference. So previously on the 6R80, it made right around 850. I haven't pulled that graph up to confirm the number, but right around 850 with it locked up on 14.5 pounds. Honestly, I know the converter is going to be pretty loose with this. It is a PTC. It is a good converter. They generally dyno well also. But if it makes anything over 700 at that same boost level, I'll be happy. You know, we keep in mind, we don't race dynos, right? So, the number is just a number. I'm doing this mostly just for curiosity for anybody else doing the swap and just curious myself. So yeah, I do have to rig up a couple things. I didn't check my CO2 bottle before I got here and it's empty, so I've got to put a regulator to the airline and run just shop air to run the wastegate. It's CO2 boost control with a leash electronics controller currently. So, but yeah, I'm going to get some heat into this thing and get the airline hooked up to the CO2. There won't really be much tuning to this. It's pretty rare. I haven't messed with the engine tune-up in over a season, so we keep it pretty conservative being all stock stuff. But yeah, so I'm going to get the airline hooked to this thing, some ice in the air-to-water intercooler set up, and see what it makes. All right, we got that mug full of ice. Put like 3/4 of a bag in it, so I'm hoping we just fill it up once and don't have to worry about it again the rest of the time we're here today. So, so I wanted to show you the regulator setup, just super simple, right? It's a regulator I normally use for boost leak. Sorry, I think I have my hand over the mic. It's a regulator I normally use for boost leak checks, so I just stuck the line out of the CO2 tank or the fitting out of the CO2 tank in here and stuck it to 80 pounds because that's where I had the tank regulated. And yeah, that's it. I think we're ready to get some heat into everything and make a couple hits, so see what happens. All right, so that was the first hit. It was insanely rich, like 0.68, buried the wideband rich. It was pulling 14% and it's still 0.68, and it made 604. I bailed early because it was just not running clean. But yeah, still made 604, on 12 pounds. So I remember, as I was doing that, I remember that the last time I was at the track, we had the thing turned up to, I don't know, like 20 pounds. And we ran out of injectors, so I bumped the base fuel pressure up to, I think, 60-65 pounds. So that's why it's overly rich there. I'm going to take a minute, drop the fuel pressure back down to 45 pounds of base, and try that same hit again. Obviously, we're close on boost level. Just got to get the fueling so it can control it again. And then, yeah, we'll make another hit on 12 pounds, and then we'll turn the thing up to 14 once it's happy. And it sounds good. Trans works, so that's cool. I'm going to keep working on it. We'll be right back. All right, so that was on 12 pounds again, just with the fueling change. Picked up like 30 horsepower, 40 some foot pounds of torque. So time to turn the boost up. This thing's super conservative. That's why the graph looks so jumpy. It's only got 17 degrees of timing in it, so it's super safe. And intake temps were like 52 degrees on 12 pounds of boost, you know, 0.75 AF or lambda, right? So it's, she's insanely conservative. I could definitely put some timing in it at this boost level and gain a bunch of power. But that's not really our goal here, isn't a power number. We're just trying to test before and after. So now that the fueling's back to where it should have been, I'm going to put, say, 3 pounds of CO2 in it, see if that'll get us up to 14.5 pounds of boost, and see what it makes. If it makes over 700 on the unlocked 400, I'd be pretty happy. That would mean we lost somewhere around 140 horsepower, I think, from locked to unlocked. But I'm going to put some CO2 in it, and we'll find out. Okay, so that was like 13.5 pounds. I didn't turn it up quite enough, but in the past before I said was 12, it should have been 12. It was like 11.5. So we went up 2 pounds of boost and picked up like 50 horsepower. And about 50 foot pounds of torque too, actually. So, and you see how the curve's looking better. As I said before, the thing's so conservative at the low boost levels that it's like kind of all over the place. So. You can see here how that the curve is smoother than the pole before. That's just because we're getting closer to the tune-up being more ideal. So I put 1.5 pounds more CO2 in it. I'm going to let the thing cool down for a bit. I don't have a trans temp gauge in this, so I'm going to put some fans on it, let it cool down for probably 10 minutes or so here with some fans on it, and let her eat again. Good news is there's nothing, everything's working great, no issues there. So I'm gonna probably top the ice off in the intercooler again, and let it cool off and make another hit with the CO2 turned up. That'll probably be the last one. Mathematically we should make just over 700, which would mean we lost somewhere around, it made 853 before, so if we make just over 7, we lost somewhere around 150 horsepower going from the 6R80 to the Turbo 400. That's why knowing the combination when you're looking at dyno numbers is just so crucial, because you never know. I mean, this converter's a PTC, it's a coupled well, it's not going to slip much under couple, but it is a pretty loose converter. I didn't even look at what stall speed was that time actually, but it should be around 6,500. So just keep that in mind when you're looking at dyno numbers, as this is literally the same tune-up minus the fuel changes I had to make that it was on when it made 850 on 14.5 pounds with the lockup converter in it. So definitely interesting information there. But I'm gonna let it cool off, top the ice off, like I said, and we'll make one last hit with it here and see if we can break that 700 mark. Alright, so real quick, before I show you guys the graph, to show you how much power change there was from the 6R to the Turbo 400. For you guys out there that are familiar with calculating horsepower from injector duty cycle, so this is a 0.75 lambda, 14.5 pounds of boost. It's got injector dynamics 1300s in it, and it is at 45 pounds of base pressure. I believe there's injectors are flowed at 43.5, so whatever, close enough. And it's 90% injector duty. If you're not familiar with doing that math, a rough online calculator would tell you it's around 1,000 flywheel. All the differences in these two graphs is 100% just parasitic differences between the converter unlocked and locked and the different transmissions. I wouldn't say that the Turbo 400 is less efficient. This is a full roller, you know, Rossler close ratio, pretty gnarly 400. So I'm assuming it's fairly efficient, but I know the 6R is also extremely efficient in comparison. But the biggest difference here is definitely the converter, the unlocked versus locked deal. But yeah, check out these graphs. All right, that's it. That's what you made. 710, 610. That was exactly 14 and a half pounds. The uncorrected numbers were 720. I don't remember the torque number. But just for reference here, I'm going to pull up my old 6R, the 6R80 dyno graph at the same boost level so you can get an idea how much different the curves are. If you notice, this list is super long. You can see I've had a couple cars on the dyno of my own one time or another. Holy cow. So yeah, the last time I had this car on the dyno was actually 2019, which I think is kind of funny. But let's check that out. All right, and the numbers. All right, so check out the difference in the curve. You can see the car comes up fairly similar. Now, I don't know what RPM I was starting to pull at previously, I suppose, what RPM was rolling in the throttle. But just the shape of the curve is even quite a bit different, as you can see the converter working. So that's over. To give you an idea what the RPM graph looks like, to 7,500. And there's the power number differences. So, yeah, definitely interesting what swapping to a Turbo 400, you know, completely different style of transmission and converter will do. This is literally the exact same tune-up it had in it at that point. I had to pull a little bit of fuel back out of it because I had added some fuel later after I had tuned it, but the timing map and the fuel targets are all identical as it was for them. The only other difference is the hood exit on the car, which you would argue is probably worth a little bit of horsepower, if anything. Definitely didn't hurt it, but yeah, so definitely interesting. This is, it's again, all why you need to know when you're looking at dyno numbers. This is why we don't race dynos, because that's 150 wheel right there just in a transmission swap. So imagine if it was a stick, it'd probably dyno a lot like the 6R, I would assume. But yeah, so anyway, that's it for this thing today. I'm gonna get this thing out of here, back in the trailer, and head home and probably start working on research and putting the Haul Tech setup in it. So hope you guys liked it.